YouTube. This is second time this Lent that we've gone live. And today is an interesting day in that, buonasera. I would talk to Maria, but she gets mad at me. So I just got caught off guard. Today is the Roman Station Church of Santa Balbina. It hasn't been open since 2017 or 2018, or maybe even earlier. I started doing the Roman Station Churches in, like, going every day during Lent in 2016. And, or 2017, actually, the second year I was living in Rome, and we went to Santa Balbina. But since then, there was some damage and restoration, and the nuns have yet to open it. It's connected to, it's kind of hidden away, and it's connected to an elderly home. And so the nuns kind of occupy themselves with that. And just like, I mean, it was one of those one situations where it wasn't open as often, except for the liturgy. And so, hi, Dad. Peter's watching too, I think. You guys can chat. It's just like San Lorenzo and Panisperna and a few other Roman station churches, they're not open all the time. So actually, I'm going live today because I wanted to show you just everything that's going on in Piazza Venezia. I feel like every day they move it around, so it's kind of a maze. And I'm going live because I don't have a video for you today. Tomorrow we go to Santa Cecilia, St. Cecilia, which is one of my favorites. And yesterday we went to San Clemente, which... For those of you who don't know, when I first came to Rome, I was a pilgrim as a senior in high school in 2009. And I traveled to Rome with a priest who had studied and some students and college students from a focused Catholic group. And we arrived in Rome on a Friday, and it was Lent. So Friday during Lent, and we immediately got onto a charter bus and went to Assisi and stopped on the way up to Assisi. We stopped on this auto grill, which is what they call like a rest stop, with like a restaurant and cafe and sometimes gas, petrol. I don't know. Anyways, we thought, oh wow, this is great. We're paying for this great pilgrimage and we're stopping at a rest stop for a meal. But it ended up being just typical Italian, nice, meal. We're kind of the only ones there on this Friday in Lent. They served us like pea soup or something. It's another, and a fish. Anyways, then we went to Assisi, and St. Francis of Assisi is the patron I chose as, I'll pause this story. So you have all of these works going on. If you've ever been to Rome, let me go up higher and you can see. So as you can see, it says Roma Metropolitane Lavori Linea C for the C line. We have some nice music over here of 1,000 years. So you have all this work going on, which I can't understand when it's supposed to be done. You know, you say it and everyone says 2030 it's going to be done. Who knows if anything's going to be ready for next year? My understanding was that for the Jubilee year, which is 2025, which, by the way, people are talking, I'm talking to people about organizing a pilgrimage for the Jubilee. So just keep that on your horizon if you're interested in having kind of a really Crux Stationalis Roman Station Church pilgrim itinerary during what is my favorite week of the Roman Station Churches, the fourth and fifth weeks, kind of going over that weekend of Passion Sunday. So anyways, we have all these works. So the traffic in Rome in the morning is crazy. And to get through Piazza Venezia, you have to kind of choose your poison of which way you're going to go. I'm really only going this way because it's kind of more scenic. And because I also don't know where I'm going. But here we are. So this metro stop that they're building here, I'm thinking, my understanding is for 2025, there might actually be like a stop that you can use, but the whole complex will be made ready for like 2030, which it will be basically a museum. So it'll be like all these levels to the stops. I don't know, your city has a metro, but a subway. But, you know, some of the stops here in Rome are like kind of basic. You just in and out. Some other ones, you go down to like the depths of Rome in a way, which sometimes can be scary. And then sometimes you have like escalators, which are just missing. And there's like, you don't even know how deep these holes go. And sometimes they're playing country music. A year ago, I was in one, and they were playing this, I don't even know. I called my brother or my dad or something to, because I was just so shocked that it was some random 90s country music from America. Anyways, so this whole thing, so usually this piazza is, you know, just one way. Just kind of all the way around, and it kind of just goes like this. Now they've cut off that whole side of the piazza, and this is now a two-way street. And so in the mornings, like I said, this morning I was on, my train was late, like 30 minutes, and then they kept adding stops to the train because the train before was broken down. And so I knew, gosh, I should get off the train over by St. Peter's and walk, which is quite a long walk. But then I stepped onto a bus, only because it's so miserable to walk through here, even though it's not so much more fun to be on a bus, but at least you get to sit and relax. So today I'm just walking around, giving you the option to see Rome. It's been cloudy. It's not so cold. Yesterday was cold. Kind of we got this resurgence of winter. And I'll point out things as we pass. This is a Roman station church, San Marco. It's next week or 2 weeks, I can't remember. But it's interesting. Last year, we processed with this cross, which had been stolen. And it's really interesting. Italy, the amount of effort that Italy puts in sort of maintaining its patrimony and just the value they put in the culture. This cross had been stolen and was found. There's like a corps of police that are just devoted to this sort of finding lost or stolen artifacts. And this one was found and restored. And so last year for the Roman Station Church Mass in the evening, we gather in just in the portico of the church. And this cross was blessed again and carried in procession. And then they haven't done it for years, but then usually we process into the church and there's a crypt. And we go through the crypt to see where the relics of San Marco are. Mostly his relics are in Venice, at the cathedral in Venice, Italy. But here there are some relics, and we usually process down there, at least the first year. It's funny, the first year that I did the Roman Station Churches, 2016 or 17, a lot of the things we did that year, a lot of the processions, a lot of the way we went down into the crypts and some things, or whatever, the relics they use, let's go through this garden actually. I'm just going on the whim of my little desire, and this garden's beautiful. That first year I did it, there was kind of like any time a church had a relic of the cross, they used it for the procession, or there were like more bishops who were celebrating the liturgies. And so, yeah, it's just interesting that some years it's a bit sparse, the decorum for the liturgy. So this is a garden that you should come if you're in Rome. It's just a nice place to hang out. It's all free to walk in. Beautiful fountain, relaxing. Maybe you can hear me going live in a video, being annoying. But it's just, you have these beautiful palm trees. You have this nice view. It's quiet view of the side of the Basilica di San Marco. And then you have this nice fountain in honor of St. Mark. You see the lion and his gospel. You can grab a sandwich and have lunch here. Yeah, it's just kind of romantic. And then I'll show you when you exit on this side how loud it is. Those of you who are just joining, I don't know if there's any comments. I've checked. For those of you who are joining, I'm just walking through Rome. I was at university and I have to go into the EWTN office today. And so I wanted to take you live as I'm walking towards St. Peter's. Just up on the right is an Irish pub that some students from the Angelicum are known to frequent for St. Patrick's Day. And on the left, up here, is the Church of the Gesù, which is the like epitome of a church post Council of Trent, in the sense that it takes away a sort of parceled church, which has many altars, many little chapels, many nooks and crannies, and it's built in a way to emphasize the centrality of the sacrifice on the main altar, the celebration of the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass on the main altar, especially with the, oddly, the emphasis here architecturally is to have the tabernacle at the center, but if you go in, you'll see that the Blessed Sacrament is reserved in this beautiful little chapel dedicated to the Sacred Heart. I've shown it on my Instagram. I don't know if it's been here on YouTube, but I am planning after Lent to explore not just the Roman Station churches here on YouTube, but to give you a sort of grander vision of the churches of Rome. And thank you, Karen, for your comment. I'm glad you join us for the Roman Station churches. One day I will get into Santa Balbina again, and I'll be able to make a video for you of that church. Beautiful frescoes. I'll put some pictures here as a post on YouTube later today of the interior from when I was able to visit the church. Rome is busy, so it's February. Usually February is a low season, but there's a lot of people. It kind of goes in waves culturally based on, nationality-wise, based upon the time of the year that people might have holiday, and so right now there's a lot of I don't know if there's Spaniards or South Americans, but a lot of Hispanics in the city for some reason regarding probably holidays in respective countries. And I think French come in March quite typically. Let's go walk past the Pantheon. And I tell you that just because Rome is basically, for the next year and a half, 2 years, is just going to be packed. Especially next year, they're expecting, gosh, I don't know what they said, 50 million for, is that possible? pilgrims for the year, tourists for the Jubilee year. But don't worry, I'll take you through the streets of Rome myself. I forgot what it was. Oh, I was telling you at the beginning of the video, I was telling you about San Clemente. So yesterday we went to the San Clemente, beautiful mosaic, if you saw the YouTube video. And I'm sure I'll be getting some shorter videos in the shorts here on YouTube and also reels on Instagram. And it's a church which is near and dear to my heart because, by the way, this restaurant's good. There's a little church over here to San Antonio, but I think it will be close. Yeah. But San Clemente is near and dear to my heart because, like I was saying at the beginning of the video, we arrived at Assisi for like a day and a half, which felt like we were there for, like, you can feel your time in Assisi, like every moment is a very grace-filled moment. So you feel like you're there for much longer than just a day and a half, in the good sense. And then we went to Orvieto. I have some videos here on YouTube which explore the miracle of Orvieto and the cathedral and everything. Fun videos. And then we got to Rome on Sunday evening and we were sleeping in Trastevere. Let's go by the Marmo di... Oh no, let's go this way. And then Monday morning, we had to wake up very, very early. And we didn't really know what we were doing. I had no idea what Roman station churches were. Again, this is in 2009, 15 years ago. I can't believe that. And the priest said, okay, we're going to go here. We don't know what station means, station church, station liturgy, anything like that. We knew what the North American College was. And so we leave, I don't know, at 6 a.m. in order to walk from Trastevere all the way over to the Colosseum. And we get there, we're running late, and we join the 7 a.m. Mass with the North American College students and priests, which, so you know, I follow here the evening liturgies, typically, for the Roman Station churches, but there's also many who follow the 7 a.m. Masses where they go Monday through Saturday to the stations. Sometimes they alternate or switch out a station based, I don't know why, but they do. Here's anyone who's interested, Gamarelli, Santa Maria, I am blanking on the name, Sopra Minerva, where St. Catherine of Siena is buried. I'll definitely have to do a video inside of here. I have a friend who lives in this monastery, in this convent, and he'll be able to show me. He teases me because yesterday I left class. I left my second hour to do a live on Instagram and to go to the station church because I couldn't miss San Clemente. And let me finish that story. So we got there in San Clemente. And so it was the first sort of morning in Rome and the first church I visited, San Clemente. And so I had no idea what a Roman station church was. And it wasn't until last year, in an interview with EWT and Vatican, they were asking me about these questions. And I'm sitting there with this journalist and she's saying, we're talking about it. And it just hit me that, this is the backside of the Pantheon. It just hit me that San Clemente was the first Roman Station Church that I went to, and the first church ever that I visited in Rome. And so the Roman Station churches have been sort of part of my whole Roman experience from the beginning, 15 years ago. It was basically, Lent was started later, Easter was later. Which, by the way, I'm loving when Easter is early. I'm loving when Lent starts a bit earlier. Next year, Easter is like April 20th or something. So it's always harder as you're going through Lent and it starts getting sunnier. And at least for my melancholic self, I like cloudy days when you're fasting. So if you don't know, for the Pantheon, you now need a ticket, and I need to actually look into how to purchase a ticket. I'm giving a tour in 2 weeks. I'm leading a pilgrimage in 2 weeks, actually. So it's like 12 days of 58 pilgrims that I'm leading around the city. And we're going to Assisi and Laverna, which I've never been to. And Foligno, which I've been nearby Foligno, but never there. We're going to Monte Falco and maybe Rivo Torto, which I don't even know what is there. And we're going somewhere, Perugia. So this weekend I have to go and do research and explore these places because I don't know them that well. I know Assisi somewhat. No, Orvieto. We're going to Orvieto as well. I love going with people to Orvieto. Usually when family comes, we go. And it's one of my favorite places. It's always nice. It's always nice when you... Oh, let's pass this way. Sant'Eustachio. It's always nice when... Yeah, I need to get out of this area. It is... St. Eustace or St. How do we say it in English? Hubert, who was a pagan hunter, and he was hunting one day and was about to shoot a stag, or, you know, with a bow and arrow, and the cross appeared between the antlers of the deer, and he was converted. And there's a digestivo, an after-dinner liqueur, which has the symbol of the deer, the stag, with the cross between it. And that comes from, that symbol comes from Sant'Eustachio. There's also, I would have stayed there and explained it more, but the service kept cutting out. There's the coffee shop of Sant'Eustachio. And last night, a friend, we went to dinner and then we were walking around and we had coffee and he was explaining to me that they made coffee as it was, as like in the most Italian way, in the sense that with the Second World War, the coffee that could come to Italy was only that from Africa. And so in order to, which for the Italian taste and also the Italians kind of Arabic coffee, kind of what everyone lauds is, you know, in the South they definitely have this. If you have some of the Southern brands of coffee, they definitely do use these Arabic beans, which is not the proper title of it, but Arabia beans, I don't know what we call it in English. And that taste is a bit bitter and strong for Italians. And so Sant'Eustachio, or like the first ones to adapt as a brand this reality of coffee, which was to make a cream with sugar from the first pours of the coffee. And then you pour the rest of the coffee on top of that. And that lightens the taste, the bitterness of the coffee. And so I just had a normal one, which actually didn't even have sugar. Instead, it was just sort of like aerated cream of a coffee. And my friend had one with milk and cacao on the top of it. Anyways, side bit of story about coffee. But the beans that they use are from South America, not just Acquio, and so which have a sort of smoother, you know, notes to it and things like that, which is what they were accustomed to. So they had to, and so this Santostacchio, which is actually, they still use those, or they use now those beans from South America. Their blend is that. However, at the period of time when you didn't have this import with the war and after the war from South America, they had to adapt what they could import from Africa into a way which was pleasing to the Italians. This is the Church of Santa Agnese. We are in Piazza Navona. Which way do I want to go? Oh, it's going to be closed. Chiesa Nuova. Another church I'll show you is Chiesa Nuova. After Lent, obviously. But the cupola was just restored. We're going to go this way because I don't think I've ever taken you this way on a live video. Oh, yeah, I also want to show you how right now around St. Peter's, that metro line that we were at Piazza Venezia. So it's arriving to the Colosseum, and then after the Colosseum, there should be a station at Piazza Venezia, where we were. And then there's supposed to be one at Chiesa Nuova, which if you have been following Crux for a while, that's where I used to live. It's right in the center, kind of, it's like 5 minutes that way. There's supposed to be a station there, which will just be crazy. There's a big piazza there. It's well connected to the 64 line and the 40 line. By the way, this facade was just restored over the last like year, and you can see this beautiful Madonella, it's called. These images of Our Lady in Rome. But it's very beautiful, very unique. Let's see if I can zoom in. Can I zoom in? So, Mary, our advocate, pray for us. Oops, I'm making sure it's not too. Okay. By the way, thanks for joining me. I know it's early in America for all of you. Some people are watching from Italy as well. 19, I think, is the most we've ever had on, you know, a live video on YouTube. So I'm happy for that. Up here is another Roman station church, St. Apollinarius. And this is another pontifical university as well, run by Opus Dei. And if you were watching in the first week of Lent, if you go through there, there's just another Roman station church, St. Augustine's Church, which was originally the station of St. Trifone. But that church doesn't exist anymore, but the relics are kept at Sant'Agostino, the Church of St. Augustine. So, what was I saying? Oh, I'm happy that you're all here. Nice number on my video. And we're walking to the river. We're just a couple steps away from the river. And then we'll walk to St. Peter's. I used to walk this way quite often when I first lived in Rome. So my friend was asking me about my sort of why am I even living in Rome? So I, as I said, I came on a pilgrimage in 2009. And of course I loved Rome. And I thought, wow, once in a lifetime experience for this guy from Nebraska. And it's funny, yesterday, I wrote an article for EWTN about the tradition on Saturday at St. Peter's Basilica. Last Saturday, we went to St. Peter's for the station, and there was the exposition of the Lance of St. Longinus. And so, nice photographer came from EWTN, made these amazing photos of the Lance and the blessing and the liturgy and everything. And then I made some video, and there was a reel published yesterday, EWTN Vatican in collaboration with Crux Stationalis. And the nice thing is a lot of people have seen it. And so I wrote an article to accompany these photos and the video and everything. And now I forget why I was telling you that. Oh, in the bio of the article, it says, though, Jacob Stein studies in Angelicum, comes from Omaha, Nebraska. And my friend said, why don't you say Papillion? And I said, well, Papillion's a bit obscure for, let's see, where can I cross? I don't want to cross there. It's a bit obscure. And he said, Omaha's obscure too. But anyways, I never thought in 2009 when I came on pilgrimage that I'd really ever even be back to Rome, you know? And then I was a seminarian and I studied abroad for one of the semesters. My university had, I'm glad you're gonna be using my guides on Rome when you come. And I'm hoping that I'll kind of organize my material in a way that lets you explore Rome. I do have a map on Google Maps, which sort of gives you the Crux Stationalis itinerary and links also to my YouTube videos. Anyway, so then I studied abroad for a semester in 2011. And that was in the fall semester, so I wasn't here for Lent and all the Roman station churches. But I started to learn more about it then, because usually those seminarians that came on the spring semester would go also to the Roman station churches and things like that. So it was sort of like in the air. And then after that, you know, I have a really close Roman friend that I met then in 2011. And don't do what I'm doing. Listen to the street signs and lights and everything. That friend, shortly after 2011, started coming sort of off and on to the Roman station churches. And then from 2014, she started coming every day and her photos would be published on new liturgical movements. So I was like vicariously living through Agnese, who I call the Pellegrina Romana, the original Pellegrina, pilgrim of Rome for the Roman station churches. Here we are looking at St. Peter's. By the way, how's the quality of the video? Seems a bit. One thing that YouTube wants like creators to do is stream, not landscape, but stream portrait mode, like everything else on all the other apps. But I refuse to do that because you see a lot more this way. A lot more beautiful. So this is a spot that everyone comes in the evening when there's a sunset to take a picture of St. Peter's Basilica. Just so you know, there's a beautiful day. And the nice thing about the winters in Italy are beautiful sunsets. Yesterday, Friday, I went down to the beach because there was a train strike. And I said, during Lent, I usually don't get to experience the evenings by the beach or by the seaside. And so I went there and it just was like breathtaking, the sunset. So back to my line. So I studied abroad bit grainy. Yeah, it looked grainy to me. So I assumed you weren't seeing what I'm seeing. It doesn't shoot obviously in 4K when I'm streaming, because that would take immense bandwidth to get to you. Just gives you an impetus to watch the other 4K videos on Stationalis YouTube. So I studied abroad, loved it. Then my friend grew in her devotion to the Roman Station churches. I even quoted her in my article about the lamp. Or actually, no, I wrote another article about the Roman Station churches, which is coming to EWC in Vatican. So I'll note to that when that comes out. And anyways, then I didn't finish my philosophical studies in the seminary. So I was comfortable with Rome. I had friends here. I knew the parish of Trinità. And I knew the Angelicum. So I said, I might as well go and study at the Angelicum. In the time that I was preparing to come and everything, the sacristan position became available at Trinità. And so I was able to be sacristan for a couple of years there and live there and be very immersed in the life there. And yeah, then I've just been studying all this. And then I moved from Trinità to Chiesa Nuova to be a guest of the Oratorian Fathers. And then during that time, the lockdowns and everything happened. Lockdowns happened, and that sort of kept us in Rome for like 2 years, just being unable to go here or go there, or at least being unable to change your living situation without great difficulty. And so last year I moved out by the seaside by the recommendation of friends, and an apartment became available, and it's beautiful, and it overlooks the sea basically, and the facade of the church, which isn't, my friends call it the Times New Roman Church because the font of the church title of Chiesa di San Giuseppe is this like horrible script, and it's just like Bauhaus, the architecture. So here we are. We're looking at the Bridge of the Angels. So if you saw the second video of this series, which is for Sexagesima Sunday. Actually, no, sorry. It's Quinquagesima Sunday, so the third one. Right before Lent starts, we come to St. Peter's, and I show you the Bridge of the Angels. So if you have, it always happens with those three, with Septuagesima, Sextagesima, and Quinquagesima, that very few people see them because I'm not in full swing with daily videos. So go check that out if you haven't seen it. But I give you a detail of all of each of the angels, what they signify, because this bridge is basically, it's a pilgrim bridge. It's an old Roman bridge. The three middle arches are from a Roman bridge, the Aelian bridge, Pons Aelius, not as like extraterrestrial, but Aelian bridge. And there was a series of statues here, which were like the patriarchs of the church and Noah, Moses, Abraham, and I don't know who else. And it was just a different series. And then there were commissions for a certain type of bridge, and eventually it became these, which were under the school of Bernini, who did two of them. So it's been like this for about 300 years, a little less, and meaning the statues. And the statues, it's just like quintessential Lenten, quintessential Crux Stationalis, in the sense that they're holding instruments of the Passion.
And it used to actually be, it's a toll bridge. So you used to have to pay to cross the bridge. And like, you know, like we, the taxation in ancient Rome, but then also in early, you know, in Christian Rome, medieval Rome, even up to Baroque Rome, was much more elective. I think Julius Caesar ran Rome, ran the Roman Empire on like 2 days of taxation total for each citizen. But so this used to be a toll bridge. And then you'd have things like tolls. So you have these elective sort of payments, which... making sure people don't get mugged or something. So it's a beautiful bridge, even on a gloomy day like this. And I'm going to show you. So there's Santo Spirito in Sassia. And there's the tower for... there's a tower for the new church of Santo Spirito in Sassia. Because this is actually... it was never a church. It was a chapel and a hall for the infirm. It's a hospital that sits right there in the foreground. And behind that is Santo Spirito in Sassia. And then you lead up to St. Peter's. And I'm sure you know from videos in the past, or you just might know from general knowledge, that this is sort of the view we're supposed to have on St. Peter's. We're going to go and I'll take you to Via Conciliazione with this video. But you're supposed to kind of see this dome and try to find your way to it. And then you go through the streets, especially this street right here, which is Borgo Santo Spirito. And you sort of come across this massive welcoming piazza with the arms, and you just kind of get drawn into it and overtaken by the grandness of the basilica. As opposed now, which wasn't completely off the table for the original design, but there were kind of older designs for this straight street which led to St. Peter's, but they want... oh, interesting that the quality changed of the video. That wasn't then how it was designed. But in 1950, Via Conciliazione was built. It was a part of the whole restructuring of the city intended by Mussolini. Anyways, it is clear, huh? So, Castel Sant'Angelo, which I will tell you embarrassingly, I've never been into. The most I've seen inside of it is from the Opera Tosca. So, all of the statues, of course, are in this sort of same design, but Bernini only carved these two with the cross and with the titulus of the cross, the I-N-R-I. These aren't the originals. The two originals of these statues stand in Sant'Andrea delle Fratte, which, of course, I'll add to the videos of that we will explore after Lent. So it's actually quite calm over here compared to normal, which is either an indication of it being February or it's an indication of how unpleasant it is to walk where we're going to walk right now. But these works here, in my understanding, are not just renovations for the Jubilee year, but also intended for a metro stop. So that C line that I've been talking about this whole time is meant to go from the Colosseum to Piazza Venezia to Chiesa Nuova and then St. Peter's, and then we'll reconnect to the A line over by like Ottaviano or something, which is... so if you want to take the metro now to St. Peter's, once you get off the metro, you still have like 10, 15 minutes to walk to St. Peter's. I never do it because it's just like completely out of the way for me. So at the moment, this is what you see. In order to get to St. Peter's, you have to go through this garden and walk along. I don't know what this is called, actually. But you might know that Castle Sant'Angelo was used for protection for the Pope. And so the Pope would have been able to travel from St. Peter's through this wall and arrive safely at the fortress here of Castle Sant'Angelo. But it is, I mean, it's not horrible to have to, you know, just walk from here to the garden, but it just adds a couple minutes when you're in a rush. I'm known for being quite impatient and liking to get places fast and things like that. So we've spoken about the Castle Sant'Angelo and St. Michael being atop the castle in the Roman Station Church for Santa Maria Maggiore. Last Wednesday, we went to Santa Maria Maggiore, and I spoke that Wednesday about the Salus Populi Romani and how the icon was carried through the streets of Rome to ask her protection from a plague. And in the course of the, and I show you in a picture from the Vatican Museums, I'm sorry, a painting from the Vatican Museums, of that procession. And in the course of that procession, St. Michael appeared atop Castle Sant'Angelo. I think there was lightning in that as well. And because, you know, it's quite common that St. Peter's, for example, gets struck by lightning for its great height and also, I'm guessing, the metal and things like that. It's not from, like, bad omen or something. Anyways, so St. Michael appeared atop the castle here and the plague went away. Good old intercession of the saints. And so in that procession, the Salus Populi Romani was carried through. And so she's this protectress of Rome for the health of Rome and all other ways of being this sort of refuge for Rome. So here we are just walking along this wall. And you can see the, what's it called? San Lorenzo, there's a piazza inside the Vatican called San Lorenzo, and we're walking to St. Peter's, Basilica di San Pietro in Vaticano. This neighborhood of Rome is called the Borgo. So all these streets are also called Borgo Santo Spirito, Borgo Sant'Angelo, Borgo Pio, Borgo Vittorio. Let's walk. I'll take you down Borgo Pio, and then we'll walk from there to... Ah, no. Well, tell me, do you want to go down Via Conciliazione or Borgo Pio? I'll wait for your... Should I just decide myself? We've gone down Via Conciliazione before, so maybe I'll take you down Borgo Pio. Left? You want to go left? So sure. So it's either going there or going down Via Conciliazione. Left means Via Conciliazione. So we'll do that. Okay. Naturally, all the lights are not working. No matter which way we go, it's full of people.
Like we're all sort of like put onto these sidewalks. The Romans got mad a couple months ago when they changed these streets. So usually this street used to go this way, the opposite way it's going now. And what they did was they changed the direction of that street, and then they took away where we just were, where all that construction's going on. They took away that street, which was driving in this direction. And so it may be that just for the Jubilee year, they did this to make this a walking zone. Because if you didn't have this street, in order to get from there to basically the river right there, you know, this like all the way around the Vatican, which is like, I forget the diameter of the Vatican. The perimeter of the Vatican is like, what, 3 kilometers or something? We would all feel bad if this like 200 meter stretch was cut off completely, but it would actually make this a true walking zone. Norcia. I haven't been to Norcia since before the earthquake in 2016. I went quite often because when I studied abroad in 2011, I began my semester there with a retreat. By the way, another story of thank you for enjoying my videos. I'm glad you enjoy them. Please share them as well. Always helps when you guys share the videos with people. Just be as pesky as I am. Just share. One friend told me, you don't have to send me the links anymore. I'm subscribed to your channel. But it's always good to share the links, just in case. But I began my semester in Norcia in 2011. Well, we began, first we did the Camino de Santiago, Compostela. We did that for 5 days, really. Just 108 kilometers, I think. And then I stayed in, at that time I was very enamored with the Carmelite saints. And so I visited a lot of the holy sites of these Carmelite saints, of Saint Teresa of Jesus and Saint John of the Cross. And then I also went to Barcelona. And we went to Montserrat, and we stayed in Montserrat for like 3 days, which was just glorious, because this is why I'm telling you this. Then I went to Norcia the following week for a retreat, to begin our semester with a retreat. And I was very happy to meet the monks of Norcia during that period. And they were kind of, this was 13 years ago, so definitely a different experience. It's just funny, every time I try to get to, well, usually, I think I said this like 2 weeks ago when I was traveling. Anytime I'm traveling, I have horrible things happen, cancellations or things like that. Having no clue if something falls through the lodging or something. So this was happening with this trip. It always happens when I'm especially going to a Benedictine monastery. The journey there is just like always full of so many doubts of, I never know if I'm going to get there on time. I never know if there was a miscommunication or something, because there was like communication with the monks and then nothing. Or I remember going to Norcia and I had no idea. I didn't have a cell phone. I didn't have any of these things. We just sort of like, oh, okay, we're leaving at 3 p.m. from Roma Tiburtina on the bus. Like, if you're not there, what are you going to do? You don't have a way to, I didn't really speak Italian at all. And so, luckily I got onto the bus, but there were like maybe 5 other students who didn't get on the bus. But Montserrat, we were in Barcelona and I booked a hostel, and it was supposed to be like this more private aspect of the hostel. And it wasn't. And then we just canceled our second night at the hostel. And we're just like, I guess we'll just go to Montserrat and see if the monks will take us. And we get there and they're like, oh no, actually our guest quarters are under construction, so you can't sleep there. And we're like, oh gosh, it's like 6 p.m. in the evening and no idea if we're like what to do. And at this point we're up the mountainside of Montserrat, so it's a Benedictine monastery and about like an hour north of Barcelona, which sits on a mountainside. And it's beautiful, known for its singing and things like that. And they said, the guest master comes back and says, oh, you can stay in the novitiate quarters because you're seminarians or something. And so we got to stay for 3 nights in the novitiate quarters. And it was like the best hospitality of Benedictine monks ever received. But the food was amazing, cheeses and things like that. So, anyways, not to talk about food during Lent, but anytime, that's just happened every single time. Once I went to another monastery, I was just helping to serve and kind of on retreat in a town here called Acqua Pendente. And there's like many ways to get there, but I was taking a train to Viterbo and spending a couple hours in Viterbo, seeing the town, this town I've never seen before. And then in Viterbo, you get off the train station, you have to walk across town and go to the bus depot. And this bus depot, there was two trains leaving at 3 p.m. or 3:30 or something. And they're going kind of in the same direction. So I said, you know, I had been to this place before, and I said, okay, yeah, this is right. And then all of a sudden it gets to Bolsena, which is nearby Orvieto. Bolsena is where the Eucharistic miracle happened, which we celebrate on Corpus Christi. And instead of going right, it went left, the bus, and I said, uh-oh. So I'm watching on Google Maps. I said, maybe it's just a detour, maybe it will get back on course. And then no, it doesn't get back on course. It ends up in Farnese, which, yeah, I don't know where Farnese is. I mean, I do have a smartphone at this time. But, you know, I just didn't have, you know, this typical story, making a mistake. And, but then it was nice. It was during Lent. It was a Friday during Lent. And Friday during Lent, I'm just going to rest here for a bit. And I asked the bus driver's like, are you going to get off the bus? I said, no, you're not where I need to be. And he said, you took the wrong bus. You're supposed to get on the other one. Because these buses left from the same platform at the same hour, which made no sense to me. And I'm bad at, I don't like asking directions, or, you know, I feel like a dumb when I do that. So I just assume, oh no, Jacob, you got it. You know what you're doing. And I usually don't. But then I was texting my friend Amiese, the one who introduced me to the Roman Station Churches and everything, Roman friend, and she's like trying to help me from afar. And so I'm just following the directions. The bus driver, I told him where I needed to go. He says, he's like, you need to go run up that street and wait, and a bus will pass in 5 minutes, and get on that bus, and then you're going to go to this town, which is like this very small, obscure town. I don't even remember the name of it. And then you're going to go there. And then at 7 p.m., a bus will pass, which will take you to Acqua Pendente. And so I was like, okay, that's like 4 hours from now. So I managed to get on that bus. And I was kind of like, I still didn't really know what I was doing. And the bus driver was like, well, where's your ticket? And I explained it to him. I was like, can I buy a ticket from you? He's like, no. I'm like, well, I don't have a ticket then. And I explained it to him. He says, okay, fine. Just get off. You get off on the next stop. So this is a nice thing. Usually Italians are very nice if you are polite and explain and everything. Granted, if you can't just ride on public transportation without tickets, you'll get a fine. But so then I get to this little town and I'm like, I'll explore it. And it's actually quite historic, the town. But it's just somewhere in Lazio, which is the region that Rome is in. Think like your state, the states that we have in America. It's kind of like that. And I go to the church, and they're having Via Crucis, the Stations of the Cross. And so I joined them in that, and it was just really nice. It was like these weird things that happen end up being creating like these experiences, which are stories that I get to tell you on my live videos, or that I can tell my family on during holidays. And that's what I should do. Next time, the next live video, I'll give you stories from Rome of weird things that happened, especially when I was a seminarian here. But there's like, today's like a high school field trip day, because there's all these high school students here. And this morning when I was getting on a train, there were also high school students from my town coming into the city. Anyway, so then we had Via Crucis, and I remember telling my friends, some of my Italian friends, where I was, and they said, "We have no idea where you are." And then she asked another Italian, "No idea where you are." And but I was able to join in the Via Crucis. There's all these nice old Italian women praying, singing the Sabbat Mater and everything. And I made it to Acquapendente. The priest waited to have dinner with me. And another story of horrible travels with Jake. That should be a subtitle to the blog here. So here we are. I didn't take you to the Roman Station Church today, but I figured nonetheless, it's nice to see St. Peter's again. And if you haven't checked out the article for EWTN, if you just type in EWTNVatican.com, my article right now should be the top article there, with a nice image of the relic from Saturday, of the lance of St. Longinus. And I give you the history of the lance, and I explain to you kind of what we do for the Roman Station Churches, specifically at St. Peter's. Let me see if there's anything else I need to tell you. Let me just show you the line right now. It goes to here, which is not usual for February. But if you're a pilgrim and you're not too large of a group, if you look over, so that line goes, you know, travels around the square, and then there's an entrance here, and then it kind of winds back and forth, and then you go through like three different securities. So if you're going in that line, don't go through the first security. Go through one of the other ones, because this first security is also where, if you're a pilgrim and you're going in to pray, you can go into the white tent here and say, "I want to pray, I'm going to Mass, I'm going to confession." Make sure those things are available when you're going in. And you can go in there. And then you just, I think my things just died. And then you just go through and you have to kind of be pushy and push yourself into the first security there. And that's all we have for now. Tomorrow we go to Santa Cecilia. Also, if you can say a prayer for me, tomorrow's my birthday. It's a good year, 33. And then we just every day here on YouTube and Instagram and all the blogs. If ever you're not sure, you can always go to www.romanstationchurch.com, which is my blog, which gives you kind of anything you need. So I will talk to you soon, and God bless you. Have a nice Tuesday of the second. Thank you for your birthday greetings. Tuesday in the second week of Lent. Ciao.